We must now move to questions to the Minister for Employment and Learning. I call Mr. Fra McCann. Mr. McCann.
I've got a pre-last concordia. Cast over a hand, question one.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. In light of the current budgetary position, my department does not have funding for any new initiatives to support the long-term unemployed. That said, there is already a range of provision in place to assist the long-term unemployed. In the first instance, the job seeker will receive assistance from staff in our frontline offices. Enhancements have been made to this service, including additional training for our frontline staff to assist clients and improve their job search skills and completion of application forms, as well as developing work readiness. In addition, at the point a job seeker becomes long-term unemployed, they are eligible for participation on the Steps to Success programme. Steps to Success contractors agree a progression to employment plan with each participant that identifies how they will work together to find and sustain employment for the individual. Participants will be on the programme for an initial period of 12 or 18 months, depending on their client group. Participants who remain unemployed at that point will avail of a further 6-month period of frontline support, followed by another 12 months on Steps to Success. I can confirm that my officials continuously review the provision in place to support all clients, including long-term unemployed.
Mr. McCann for a supplementary.
Thank you. And I thank the Minister for his answer. But does the Minister not accept that his current solutions are not delivering for those in long-term unemployment, but merely handing significant sums of monies to companies to deliver schemes which are often not of no benefit to the individuals?
Well, let me break that down into two elements. The second half of what he's saying is an allusion to the Steps to Success programme, I would understand. And in that regard, it's important to bear in mind they're providing a function on behalf of the economy in Northern Ireland and our wider society in terms of helping long-term unemployed back into employment. They have been set some very challenging targets, and we're looking to see a step up in terms of the level of performance, the good level of performance from the Steps to Work programme. That will be assessed in due course once we have sufficient critical mass of people going through to allow us to draw conclusions to how that programme is working. Just because the contractors may be coming from outside of Northern Ireland isn't the reason for actually dismissing their ability. And if anything, they're bringing their experience from other jurisdictions to bear into the Northern Ireland situation. However, the model we are applying in Northern Ireland has been shaped to meet our own particular circumstances. In terms of the first aspect of what he was saying, yeah, absolutely, I want to do more for the long-term unemployed. While we are seeing a situation improve in terms of our claimant count, within that, the percentage of people who are unemployed, who are falling into the long-term unemployed category, is increasing. And that is absolutely of concern to me. And I'm further concerned that I don't have access to the resources at present due to the budgetary impasse and the ongoing problems around lack of agreement on welfare reform for us to invest in this type of intervention. Once again, we are seeing money being very sadly stripped out of schemes and projects that can help people to actually gain a foothold in employment because of a very single-minded approach around how we're handling these issues.
Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And can I ask the Minister, and maybe if you could answer this without mentioning welfare reform, could I ask him what work he's doing with other departments and other ministers to try and tackle areas that are specifically and particularly affected by long-term unemployment and any other measure of unemployment, areas like my own and the Foyle constituency?
Well, I hear laughter coming from the STLP benches on the notion of let's not mention welfare reform, but actually let's mention welfare reform, because it is there, it is a reality. And the fact that we're now years into this current impasse is bleeding this executive dry, and the money is not there for us to invest in helping the vulnerable people of Northern Ireland. So it's time we move from the blinkered approach that we've had from some parties and actually start doing things that are sensible about actually helping people right across this society. So the things I would like to do, including on a geographic basis. Let me give you one clear example. We have an economic and activity strategy that was agreed by the executive in April of this year. Work on that has not commenced because there's no budget available for that. Had the situation been different in relation to our public finances, that would be moving ahead. We know that not only do we have higher levels of unemployment in the North West, we also have some of the highest levels of economic inactivity in the United Kingdom in the North West. Pilots were going to take place on a geographical basis, and that obviously means a lot of pilots concentrated in the North West. That work has not commenced because of the wrangles around budgets and, yes, again, welfare reform.
Mr. Adrian Cochrane, what?
Principal Deputy Speaker, the percentage of the Northern Ireland population who are deemed to be economically inactive is the highest of any region in the United Kingdom. It's currently sitting at 27.4%, and that compares with 27% in 2007 when devolution was reinstated. I'd like to ask the Minister, why has he finally published the economic inactivity strategy which was promised in the programme for government? Why has it taken him to publish this in April of this year, and why was it not brought forward as we now approach the end of the mandate of this House?
Well, let me be very clear, and first of all, welcome the member to the House, but also remind him that his party sat in my department for a full four-year period without doing anything in relation to economic inactivity, indeed in a time of relevant plenty in terms of resources available to us. The figures around economic inactivity have been bouncing around within the same zone for the past 30 years. We have had a situation where we've had a structural problem of economic inactivity in the region of 27% since the mid-1980s. This has persisted irrespective of the ups and downs of the business cycle through the boom times of prosperity about 10 years ago and through the current difficulties we've had with the recent recession and downturn. This is a major structural problem. It was identified in the programme for government, and we have worked diligently to produce the strategy. We're now very sadly, as I've just mentioned, at the stage where we have a strategy in place, but for other factors, there's no money available to invest in it.
Ms. Clare Sugden.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Question number two.
Ulster University first proposed establishing a veterinary school in 2013 and commenced the preparation of a business case to support this. However, a full business case has not been presented to my department. There have been no discussions with the university on this matter since June 2014. Veterinary science is one of the highest cost courses to fund, and there is currently no forecast shortfall in the number of vets until at least 2020. In the current financial climate, when funding for the higher education institutions has been reduced and undergraduate places withdrawn, it is very unlikely that funding will be made available for veterinary science courses in the short to medium term.
Sugden for a supplement.
I thank the Minister for his response. Will the Minister confirm if Ulster University is moving towards establishing centres of excellence in each campus, and that a veterinary school in Coleraine would be a perfect fit for what they're planning?
Well, in terms of the first aspect of what the Member says, as part of their response to the challenging situation in terms of funding, they have responded in a strategic way by trying to create an identity for each of their campuses, and indeed the Coleraine campuses have been identified in terms of life sciences, biological sciences, and in principle what the Member says would be consistent with that vision. The point I would ever stress to her is the high cost involved in veterinary places. And if a decision from existing resources is made to redirect resources in that direction, that would come at a disproportionate impact in terms of other provision of courses. So in a very crude sense, I mean, for every veterinary place you put in place, you may actually end up having to sacrifice almost two other types of subject places. So we have to be very conscious of what the emerging needs are for our economy, and no doubt the universities are as well, in terms of how they plan and try to work their way through what is a very challenging situation.
Could I ask the Minister what discussions he may have had with DARD in terms of the provision of a veterinary school at Ulster University?
Well, both I and my officials have had a number of discussions with our counterparts in DARD over the past number of years in this regard. It hasn't been something that's been a live issue on our agenda for the past 12 to 18 months or so, and I think that just reflects the very sad financial reality in which we currently sit. Quite clearly from my answer, the Member can take it that while some work has been done in this area, it's not work that's currently being taken forward, and in the context that where we're facing cutbacks, an investment of this type isn't deemed to be really affordable.
Mr. Robin Swan.
Question number three.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I wish to group questions 3 and 13 and would like to request an additional minute for the answer. Following publication of the Executive's draft budget in November 2014, my department published a consultation outlining the possible impact on a wide range of functions and services across the department, as well as the potential impact on the universities and colleges, including a likely reduction in student places and staff numbers. Following this consultation, efforts were made to mitigate the cuts to the higher education sector. The cuts to the universities were the last resort to balance the overall budget. I've had ongoing discussions with Ulster University in relation to the possible implications of these substantial budget reductions. While my department provides funding and sets the strategic direction for the higher education sector, universities are autonomous bodies and responsible for their own course provision and staffing levels. During these discussions, I've highlighted the need to reflect the ambitions of the executive and the objectives of the department, including the protection of narrow STEM subjects. To provide the university with some flexibility and to help mitigate the impact of the budget reduction, I've reduced the minimum requirement for direct expenditure and widening participation to 10% of the additional student fee income. This reinvestment of student fee income is undertaken to promote widening participation through outreach activities and support to less advantaged students. I understand that the university will rationalise its offerings across its campuses, with Coleraine specialising in biosciences and McGee in computing, engineering and Irish history. The university has already indicated the scale of the job losses and the loss of places over the current academic year and over future years. The size of these cuts is a clear indication of the severity of the budget reductions faced by my department, the university and the higher education sector. Before making decisions regarding course provision and staffing levels, the universities take a number of factors into account, including my department's priorities, the needs of the economy and student demand. Reviewing course provision is part of the normal annual cycle and is good business practice. It is a reflection of the current budget position that this has led Ulster University to close some courses and to consolidate others. In relation to the business case for staff redundancies, my department does not have a role in approving business case for redundancies at Coleraine, McGee or indeed any other Ulster University campus.
Mr. Swan for supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his very detailed answer. The question that I actually asked was what consultation you had with the Ulster University prior to announcement, because I think you're fully aware and you detailed the cuts that were coming, and surely at some stage there should have been a rationale or an input from the Minister or the Department with both universities to make sure that there was still provision for the likes of languages in Northern Ireland, which has now been completely lost to our graduates.
Well, first of all, let me stress that there has been ongoing discussions between myself and senior officials in both universities and also at an official level around how we plan for the cuts. This decision hasn't been taken in a vacuum. And in particular, there was a number of aspects to those discussions. We have focused on the desire to protect narrow STEM subjects. Those are the science, technology, engineering and mathematics subjects. We've also had discussions about how we can give the universities some ability to free up how they use their own resources with a view to maximising the number of student places that were retained. And it's in that context that we reduced the minimum requirement of spend of additional fee income on widening participation from 25% to 10%. That action alone has probably managed to save a couple of hundred places in each of Queen's University and Ulster University. Ultimately, the decisions to be made are for the university to make, based around a number of factors. I'm certainly conscious that they have approached this in a strategic manner. Obviously, a number of course closures will spark a reaction. Indeed, all course closures will spark a reaction. But it's important that what lies beneath those decisions is analysed in greater depth in terms of the factors around things like enrolment levels and where students are coming from in terms of the decisions that actually were made.
Sir John Dallett.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I listened very carefully to the Minister, and can I say I'm absolutely delighted that he's here today despite his party's best efforts to collapse the Assembly through their support for adjournment. But now that he is here, can the Minister tell us, is the Ulster University now at variance with our own economic strategy, which is to educate young people to a standard where they're capable of attracting new inward investment, which of course is a main argument for dealing with corporation tax? Or, as I suspect it, is the Minister sitting on his hands?
Never.
Well, first of all, I would have thought someone who's a long experienced Deputy Speaker would know the rules around supplementaries being relevant to the questions, but given he's mentioned the wider political scene, let me address that. The actions that were taken by my party were about creating stability for the context for talks to occur. And the fact that actually we're currently having talks about talks, I think in some respect actually vindicates that, because the situation that we are currently facing is one of huge uncertainty. That said, I continue in my role as a minister, and I'm fully committed to delivering in terms of my own responsibilities, in terms of all my functions around skills and employability. I'm certainly not sitting on my hands today, or indeed any other day. Let me be very clear. We are in difficulty in terms of how we ensure that we are living up to the ambitions of the agreed economic strategy of the executive, because we know that skills are the key driver behind the transformation that we want to see in terms of our economy. And across a whole range of fronts, very sadly, we are de-investing in terms of our skills offer. So any loss of university places means that we are providing less locally provided higher level skills. That is detrimental to our local economy. Within that, we will act strategically to try to protect those areas that are most relevant to the needs of our economy. And it's in that context that we did make the request to the universities to protect the narrow STEM subjects, given that those are cited in particular by both local companies and indeed investors. Now, there is a particular issue around modern languages, and we need to see what other provision can be made, in particular around how we can use the academy model that we have devised under our Assured Skills programme to see if we can actually address some of the very particular business requirements in terms of languages that companies have identified.
Mr. Phil Flanagan.
I declare an interest as a current student of the Ulster University again. Can I ask that the Minister, given the launch of his big conversation this morning, what help his department can provide to the Ulster University to help increase the levels of private investment it gets both from students and from companies without looking directly at increasing tuition fees?
Can I first of all welcome Sinn Féin's conversion to the free market, in the sense that the best way the universities can prosper is not through state funding, but they need to go out and find money from the private sector. Of course, this has to be a balance between a range of different funding sources, including the state, and also greater access to that funding. Now, we see this happening in a number of areas. We see it happening in terms of knowledge transfer through programmes such as Connected and HIFE, the Higher Education Innovation Fund. It's also worth noting that the business community interaction of our local universities proportionally is well in excess of our population share within the United Kingdom, and that's an area where our universities have been very proactive. Where I think there is scope for improvement is in our ability to access research funding from the UK research councils. We're also looking to see what we can do around drawing more money down from Horizon 2020. And as the member will know, we have a contact point in place in conjunction with the Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investment, where we have dedicated people who are there to assist with applications being made to the European Union. And we are seeing some very positive developments in that regard. So those are some of the things that are happening across the universities. But ultimately, if people think that simply passing this on to the private sector to fill the void somehow allows us to duck what is the fundamental challenge of how we resolve how the state interacts with the universities, I think that they're deluding themselves. That's where the core issue is, and that's where the key aspect needs to be addressed.
Mr. Basil McCray.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, the financial stability of the university sector, given what you know at the moment, do you anticipate that there will be further redundancies in following financial years unless action is taken?
At this stage, the announcements that have been made are in the context of the cuts that have been made. And as those cuts are currently in the baseline of the department, the universities will project that ahead. However, as we meet today, it is worth noting that we are literally only a matter of weeks away from decisions having to be made by the executive in relation to a draft budget for the 16-17 financial year. That's presupposing we actually get through the issues around managing the existing 15-16 budget, which, as members will know, is considerably out of balance. And within that, it remains to be seen what direction we are going to take in terms of the funding for higher education. In the context where decisions deteriorate ever further in terms of and have an impact on funding, then there may well be further impact in terms of both student places and the ability to retain staff.
Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And I'd just like to ask the Minister, he speaks about the independence of the university, and I just wonder what strategic role he has in these decisions. So, for example, the decision to close the School of Modern Languages, leaving us in Northern Ireland without third-level education in German, for example. That seems to be counter-strategic, given his aims. What influence can he bring to bear?
Well, universities are autonomous bodies, and they are not NDPBs. So this false assumption that they operate under a similar governance structure to a range of other public bodies. However, the state does provide them with a considerable level of funding. We interact with them through a number of different areas in terms of their funding each year. There will be a formal a funding letter that sets out a number of expectations, and within that we have focused around protection of STEM development in terms of how they can interact with the apprenticeship strategy, our expectations around widening participation. We also have a higher education strategy in place, Graduating to Success, which was published in April 2012, and that remains a live document, and that was devised in cooperation with all of our higher education institutions, and that is currently being implemented. And notwithstanding the current challenges around budget, we're still working through those projects, and indeed a number of those projects have now been concluded.
Ms. Clare Sugden.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I asked this question as a priority, but the Minister's late in answering it, so I'm quite happy for him to answer me now. Has he received an HR1 in respect of the job losses and then subsequent the loss of the school and then the subsequent redundancies from the Ulster University? An HR1, sorry.
A stage, and we wouldn't necessarily expect to see one, because this is in effect from the 16-17 academic year, and there are still discussions ongoing within the university around exactly how they're handling this.
Ms. Clare Hannah.
Mr. Speaker, question 4.
There were 84 community and voluntary sector projects funded through the European Social Fund programme. The projects could submit their claims on either a monthly or quarterly basis, resulting in up to 1,000 claims for each year of the programme. Funding for the community and voluntary sector over the last 4 years of the programme was almost £102 million, equating to just over £25 million annually. Of the £102 million, my officials have processed financial claims with a value of nearly £91 million to date. My department is currently in receipt of and processing claims received from the community and voluntary sector with a potential value of just under £9 million. There are also a number of outstanding claims with a potential value of £2.15 million for these organisations. My department has written to these organisations on the 12th of August, encouraging them to submit their outstanding claims. This will enable my department to process and pay these claims as soon as possible to the organisations. In July 2015, my department released £4.15 million in advanced partial payments to ESF project promoters to help ease financial pressures being incurred by the organisations. My department is in the closure phase of the programme, which ended in March 2015, and is therefore committed to having these claims processed as quickly as possible.
Hannah, for a supplement.
Yes. Does the Minister agree that the delays may have acted as a deterrent for future rounds, particularly to grassroots organisations, and can you outline what steps will be taken to minimise disruption and repayment in future?
Well, I don't think that the delays in themselves have had an impact in terms of future provision, because we had, in essence, two parallel processes in operation. One was the incoming programme, 2014-2020, and the second was the closure of the 2007-2013 programme. And decisions were made in relation to the incoming programme at the end of March of this year. But there has been delays, obviously, in terms of the closure of the programme, and certainly I have been frustrated with a number of issues in terms of the performance of my department. One of the things that we did do in response to that, mindful of the impact that was being felt by a number of organisations, was to put in place the system of accelerated payments, which means that rather than waiting for the full vouching of claims to have occurred, that at a risk being borne by my department, partial accelerated payments were made in order to ensure that they had cash flow.
Mr. Leslie Cree.
The junior ministers were tasked with bringing forward a strategy to help the voluntary and community sector. Is the Minister aware of the status of this piece of work, and was he involved in it himself?
At the moment, I'm not sure the status of OFM-DFM, never mind what they're doing in terms of any particular piece of work around how they can assist the community and voluntary sector. Again, that's probably something that is going to suffer from the current political impasse. I am, however, aware of discussions that have taken place within the executive in slightly happier times a few months ago around how the executive could be more proactive in assisting in a coordinated way with the community and voluntary sector. And in particular, as different departments were trying to manage a very challenging situation, that they were not simply dumping those cuts onto the community and voluntary sector, and indeed we were having a strategic approach to that. Now, for my part, I want to make a couple of points very clear. First of all, I fully endorse and respect the role that the community and voluntary sector can play in assisting government to deliver a whole range of services, and in some areas they're actually better placed than the state to provide a number of different outcomes. The second thing is that I want to be very clear, we have not made cuts in relation to the European Social Fund programme that have impacted in terms of community voluntary groups on the ground. The programme that we have actually unveiled for the 14-20 period is actually bigger than the outgoing programme. Secondly, there's been concerns expressed around match funding and whether groups will be able to access match funding from a range of different sources given the impact of budget cuts. But again, as a department, we have moved to try to plug as many gaps as we can in that regard. So we're actually spending more on match funding this time round than we have previously. That includes moving from just the 25% that we have traditionally funded in relation to the European Social Fund to whenever we have received applications, meeting some of the claims in relation to a share of the 35% aspect of the programme costs.
Ms. Anilu.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Can the Minister tell us what impact the ESF is going to have on our economy and our society?
Well, I think it's important that we do recognise that the European Social Fund is a great asset that we have to Northern Ireland. Again, it is a positive reflection of our membership of the European Union, and it allows us to do things that we wouldn't otherwise have the ability to do. It allows us to go further in terms of what we're trying to do about bringing people closer to the labour market and also promoting social inclusion. And there's a particular focus around things like economic activity, working with young people who are not in education, employment and training, and also working with those people who are with disabilities. So we have a reach and an ability to deliver that wouldn't otherwise be the case under the European Social Fund. It also allows my department to further support the work we're doing around apprenticeships and also in terms of youth training. And it has in the past supported our Apprenticeship NI programme and also Training for Success. And as we look to our new systems under the new strategies for apprenticeships and youth training, the European Social Fund, as set out in the operational programme, will be there to provide assistance in that regard as well.
Mr. Pat Sheehan.
Question 5, please.
I am committed to improving cross-border student mobility. In accordance with EU treaty obligations, my department funds further and higher education provision in Northern Ireland for all EU domiciled students. The department also contributes to the UK-wide promotion of the Erasmus Plus programme, which encourages the mobility of information, skills and people across the educational sectors between Northern Ireland and our European neighbours. Our further and higher education sectors have an excellent record in securing funding for mobility through this avenue. The project group, which was established as part of the department's higher education strategy to facilitate cross-border cooperation in teaching and learning and student mobility, continues to make progress in a number of areas. In relation to improving learner information, careers teachers and careers advisors have received additional training on the higher education opportunities available in the Republic of Ireland and on the Central Applications Office processes. Extensive information regarding Northern Ireland's higher education sector is now available through the NI Direct portal. The Irish Universities Association recently announced changes to the Central Applications Office points system to improve access for A-level students studying three subjects. My officials have been working with officials in the Department for Education and Skills to research and analyse cross-border student flows. A joint report was published on the 15th of June and shows, amongst other things, that applications from Northern Ireland students to Irish institutions has been increasing since 2010. The report will be used to inform future policy development. I and my officials continue to work closely with our counterparts in the South on this and other cross-border issues.
Mr. Sheehan for a supplement.
I got going back a slash an hour, as in Ragrushin. Could I ask the Minister, is this an issue that will feature as part of the Minister's big conversation about the future of higher education?
Well, one aspect that will feature in terms of the big conversation is actually looking at the funding model that exists in the Republic of Ireland. And again, that will be one where there's a mix in terms of reliance upon contributions from students and also contribution from the state. And the balance there would be probably closer to our existing model in Northern Ireland, albeit a model that's not sustainable, in contrast to what we're seeing in either Scotland or England. There are other forms which we're looking at the issue of student flows, and I think ultimately where the solution lies in that regard is actually trying to encourage a better two-way flow in the island. And indeed, we may well see a greater specialisation in terms of universities around some of their relevant strengths, and actually seeing the development of a more natural, larger market for students, allowing a better use of resources in both jurisdictions.
Time is up. We now move to topical questions. The members listed for topical questions 1, 8 and 9 have withdrawn their names. I call Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Thanks very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And I too am glad that the Minister is here to answer questions from us. Could I ask the Minister, he mentioned earlier Horizon 2020, a very valuable project, and indeed something that the Irish Government and its predecessor, FP7, was highly successful in realising funding for research, innovation and development. Could I ask the Minister how many projects his department has helped up until now, and what is the quantifiable amount of money that they have facilitated to realise?
That's a good question.
Well, the Member would appreciate this is still early days in terms of the new Horizon 20 programme. And as I alluded to earlier on, we have put in place a framework of Northern Ireland contact points across my department, Detty, Invest Northern Ireland, and I think DARD, Justice and possibly the Department of the Environment will stand to be corrected in that regard to ensure that we are maximising the potential to draw down. I'm particularly conscious that our universities historically have been the main source of the drawdown from previous rounds, including FP7, and that will be the situation at present. At this stage, I think we've drawn down about just over €15 million, and about €11 million of which can be identified with the universities. There are a number of other large projects that are in the mix, and hopefully there will be some very positive announcements to be made in the near future in that regard.
Mr. McGlone for a supplement.
Thanks very much to the Minister for that response. Could I ask the Minister what level of collaboration or cooperation there has been with the relevant Irish Government department or government agencies to facilitate that drawdown, because I know ETI, the Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investment, had been working on that level of cooperation to facilitate good working relationship, but more importantly to maximise drawdown of funding from this very important EU programme.
There's a number of different forms in which that type of cooperation is taking place. Obviously, we have InterTrade Ireland that can be a focal point in this regard. And more specific in terms of my own responsibilities, we have an existing network where we have a new partnership between my own department and Science Foundation Ireland in terms of the funding of research programmes. That's outside the context of Horizon 2020, but that type of collaboration provides us with a very solid foundation in which we can then facilitate potential bids on a north-south basis to Horizon 2020 in terms of universities from both jurisdictions. We also have the US-Ireland Research Alliance, which is a tripartite agreement between Northern Ireland, Republic of Ireland and the United States State Department, again, which supports collaborative research across the three jurisdictions. So both of those provide us with very strong platforms from which we can then encourage further bids in terms of Horizon 2020.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his answers thus far. Can the Minister give us a cast iron guarantee that the draconian and ideologically driven provisions that rest within the trade union bill, the Tory trade union bill, will not find its way into law in this part of the world?
I'm happy to assure the member I have no plans to introduce any similar legislation into Northern Ireland. And in saying that, let me make a couple of things clear. I think, first of all, what is happening in terms of Great Britain is disproportionate to what is the perception of problems with industrial action. And whatever problems may exist in Great Britain are not being mirrored in Northern Ireland, where, by and large, we have good industrial relations. At times, I certainly get frustrated when strike action, particularly in the public sector, takes place, especially when that's aimed not at particularly what's happening in the workplace, but wider issues around complaints about government policy. But at the same time, I respect that trade unions are part of our civic society. We have long fought for and won rights in terms of the ability to organise, and indeed they play a very active role in other aspects of civic society in terms of different protests around a number of very worthy causes, and indeed in terms of what they've done in terms of supporting the peace process. I think secondly, I don't think there will be any prospect of agreement being found on such legislation in any event, even if I was predisposed to a different outcome in terms of the viewpoints, in terms of parties in this Assembly and within the Executive.
Eastwood for supplementary.
Can I very much welcome the Minister's commitment in that regard? And can I ask him, in terms of his own employment bill, when are we likely to see that come before the House?
Well, I'm afraid that's a rather a much sadder story, in the sense that that is currently within the executive system and has been for a little while. And efforts are ongoing to see if we can find some agreement to allow that to come to the floor of the Assembly. But let me just stress, it's nothing in that that would threaten anyone's particular interest. It's about positive reform in terms of our employment law, particularly around how we can introduce stronger forms of alternative dispute resolution, which will actually make the system work better for both employees who have particular grievances that do need to be addressed, and also for employers who will have a much more streamlined approach through which these issues can be resolved to everyone's satisfaction.
Call Mr. Danny Kennedy.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, how does he react to the news today that Queen's University Belfast has slipped 12 places in the latest 2015-16? Global university rankings?
Well, let me respond to the member in two respects in that regard. The first one is that it is important that we do take account of the international context in which our universities are operating, and that they will be judged against their peers in that regard. And again, without repeating all the points I made, that's a further reason why it's important that we are investing fully in our higher education system, particularly in terms of research, which often informs these surveys. The second thing I would say is just to have a little bit of caution around surveys. As the member will know from his tenure many years ago as my predecessor in employment and learning, that there are a number of different surveys that are published, and they use different factors and different weightings of those factors in terms of reaching their outcomes. So even a university that may claim to be number one in one survey may not find themselves in the top 10 in a different survey. So I'll just say there's a slight health warning around those surveys, but for sure we don't have any room for complacency in terms of the international context in which our universities are operating.
Kennedy for a supplement.
Can I thank the member for his answer, but remind him that this is not a survey, these are rankings, world rankings, and the Minister will know that the QS world rankings are based on a number of factors, including evaluating research, teaching, academic reputation, staff-to-student ratio, and the number of international staff and students. And will the Minister take all necessary steps in engaging with Queen's University and University of Ulster to ensure that the worldwide reputation of local universities can be maintained and protected?
I'm very much committed to doing that, and I mean, we've had opportunities even on the margins this year around, for example, issues such as teacher training, where we could have actually made a bad situation just a little bit better for the universities. But it's in this context that we're doing the big conversation, because we know that there is a situation where the funding context for higher education is simply not sustainable. So we have to do all that we can. But that it does involve, for example, coming to agreements around budgets and welfare reform and ensuring that we are seeking to invest in our higher education system, not simply have a standstill situation as we look ahead to future financial years. But again, I just want to stress to the member that there are a whole range of factors in terms of these rankings. And different mixes of rankings, different weightings given to different factors in the rankings will lead to different outputs. Now, the fact that we have a drop is something we do need to take account for. That could be as much about other universities making further investments and leapfrogging ahead of Queen's as much as a deterioration in terms of where they stand. However, we are aware that in the main, there is a big challenge in terms of how we preserve the international context in which we're operating. Our universities in Northern Ireland are not here simply to serve a local population. They have to be genuine international actors in their own right. But whenever we can reach those heights, we are able to deliver inward investment in Northern Ireland, and our universities are recognised and praised throughout the world for the quality of their graduates. And it's important that we are able to consolidate and build upon the success we have rather than let that erode.
Mr. Roy Beggs.
We almost congratulate those new students who are about to embark on their higher education courses this autumn, and indeed encourage others to other forms of lifelong learning. But can the Minister advise of the numbers who will be attending local higher education courses and the numbers who have been forced to travel elsewhere?
Well, it's probably towards December, I think, of this year that we'll get the full picture in terms of admissions, in terms of this current academic year that's just about to commence. So we'll make sure the member gets a full copy of those. We have been slowly moving in the direction of increases, and we have been making incremental progress in terms of increasing local provision. Obviously, that's now a threat, and we're going in the opposite direction in terms of fewer places. And clearly, that will have an impact in terms of some people being displaced into Great Britain, and others simply opting not to go to university at all, and either having to consider other provision or simply not engaging in any further education or training. And that would be a major loss to our economy, as well as having an impact on their own personal life opportunities. It's important to bear in mind as well that whenever we see the figures, there will be a number of different factors that will influence those outcomes in terms of also things like demographics as well. So it's important that the people are fully aware of the full context whenever they see those figures, whenever they're published in due course.
Begs for supplement.
I declare an interest to a degree in that I have a son attending a local university and a daughter at a GB university. But in terms of new students selecting their universities, is the Minister aware of the differences in tuition fees between Northern Ireland and GB, encouraging more people to come here with I think it's £3,805 annual tuition fees in Northern Ireland as opposed to the £9,000. So is there any evidence of students elsewhere coming to Northern Ireland who ultimately will displace some of our students who may not be able to attend courses here and would be forced to attend courses elsewhere at £9,000 and with the additional costs associated with studying further away from home?
Well, we are seeing some increased interest from other parts of the UK in studying in Northern Ireland, which is based around the quality of courses. But I should just say to the member that for students who aren't domiciled in Northern Ireland, the universities are able to charge up to 9,000 fees for them. That was part of the wider agreement within the executive around tuition fees in 2011. And that was done on the basis that we have to protect the local market for local students. Otherwise, if they are crowded out from displacement, through displacement of students from Great Britain, we will see a situation where our students leave and do not come back on an even greater scale than happens at present. The approach we have taken in Northern Ireland is something similar to the approach obviously Scotland have taken in relation to the rest of the UK as well.
Neil Somerville.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Could I ask the Minister for an update on the success of the skills strategy for Northern Ireland?
Well, the skills strategy is a 10-year strategy running through to 2020, and there are a number of indicators in that regard around, for example, the number of people in work who will reach a level 2 qualification, those reaching a level 3, those reaching level 4, and the percentage who are engaging in terms of STEM areas. I think the biggest leap we're seeing is in terms of STEM, so I'm pleased to see success in that regard. And we're seeing good progress in terms of the level 4 level qualifications. I think probably more work needs to be done around the level 2, level 3 interventions. And obviously the challenges we have around budgets are going to create difficulties as we look ahead to the next 5 years through to the end period of that strategy.
John Mulhall for supplement.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer. But could he tell me, has there been any development in regards to the South West College in Fermanagh delivering more apprentice-based courses?
Yes, as the member may appreciate, against the wider trend, my department did receive £7.5 million of funding as part of the change fund in relation to the current year budget, and that is there to resource a number of pilots in relation to the apprenticeship strategy and also the youth training strategy. A number of those were announced earlier on this month, and the work is underway to get those up and running, and indeed South West College has been successful in a number of respects in that regard, and they've always been very proactive in terms of seeking out new and innovative ways to invest in the future of the Northern Ireland workforce.
Is up. Before we move to the adjournment debate, members will take their ease while we change the top table.